Okay, good afternoon. I'm Barry Friedman, and this is the forum. Good to see all of you. We are in this room because there was a long scheduled conflict down in Greenberg. We're going to be tight in this room, but we like each other, so that's okay. I'm going to introduce the speakers on the forum. There will be the three folks around me, and I'm going to speak a little bit as well. We're going to limit our remarks to about 6 minutes each. I probably will be briefer than that so that we have plenty of time for questions. I'm going to introduce the folks, I think, in the order in which they graduated from law school. So they are all actually NYU alums, as it happens. To my right is a man who may need no introduction, but is Troy McKenzie. He graduated in 1994. He clerked for Judge LaValle and Justice Stevens, and then he practiced bankruptcy and litigation at Debevoise and Plimpton before he wisely returned here to teach. He teaches everything, as best I can tell from looking at his resume, so he's a good person to have on this panel. To my immediate left is Kathleen O'Neill, who graduated. Are you still Kathleen O'Neill? She got married just recently. Congratulations, Kathleen. She graduated 6 years after Troy in 2000. She was came here as a PhD political scientist who was teaching political science at Cornell. She was on the International Law Journal. She left to clerk for Judge Lopez and then went to Cleary, where she is doing corporate transactional work, and despite my best efforts, has seemed not to want to go back into teaching, but I'm still working on that. Erin Scharff, if she can't get out of the building today, that will be a sign. And then Erin Scharff is scheduled to graduate 6 years after that in 2012. Erin has had a quite a career before coming. She worked in labor. She has been very active in politics, including in the Obama campaign. She's interested in tax. She's interested in a lot of policy issues. She's a TIGFA fellow and a Furman scholar. You all know me, and I will just say that I actually did not graduate from law school 6 years before Troy McKenzie, which would have put me graduating in 88?
Actually,
94.
I graduated in 2000.
Sorry, 2000, 2006, 2012. I graduated a millennium earlier. Good. So let's get started. Troy's going to speak first.
So I want to talk to you just very, very briefly about why bother, right? Why do you care about finding a substantial writing topic? Well, a couple of reasons. One, you have to. So it turns out you can't graduate from this place without writing what we used to call A papers, although I think technically it's no longer called an A paper. And lots of you will also, if you're in the process of writing what's known as a substantial writing paper, will try to get things published, right? So another reason why to do it is maybe you want to clerk for a judge. And you really can't go on the clerkship market unless you have something substantial that you've written that you can show a judge. Because what do clerks do? Well, a lot of what they do is they research and write. So you have to show a judge that you know how to do that. There are two other sort of non-purely instrumental reasons to go about this enterprise. One is if you have academic interests or pretensions, as the case may be. If you think someday you might want to enter the academy, well, why not figure out now, in part by embarking on a project that might spark an interest, might give you a taste for what academics do, might set you on a path towards a later research agenda. And finally, maybe you just simply want to influence the world, right? You want to write something that can go out to the world and can influence policymakers, can influence judges, can influence lawyers. You might not think that student writing would get taken seriously, but very often students can write on things that others might overlook. So that's just very briefly why bother. So how do you go about finding a topic? This really is not quite as hard as you might think. I know you're probably all sitting there thinking, there's so many possible things that one could write about, you know, all is contained, right? The law contains everything. Everything is contained in the law. But you've been through 1 or 2 years of law school. You have, or you're in your first year right now. You're taking classes. You were probably confused or interested or angered or amused or disgusted at some point. If you had any reaction to anything at all at any period of time in law school, then you probably have touched upon something that might be a potential topic for a substantial writing project. Maybe you have taken a clinic, and in the course of doing work for the clinic, you know, you're representing a client, and you have to stay laser-focused on the interest of the client. But it turns out that along the way, you found some really interesting thing in the law that angered you or that puzzled you, and you put it aside, and you can't come back to it during the course of the clinic. Maybe you could come back to it for a substantial writing topic. If you've practiced, if you spent a summer at a firm or in a public interest organization or some other non-governmental organization working in government, you've probably come across interesting topics. You may have been assigned a project that you've worked on. My note came out of a project I was assigned by a partner who said, you know, the Supreme Court had decided a series of cases involving bankruptcy, involving federalism, and the partner thought maybe there might be some impact on bankruptcy court jurisdiction, sent me off. It's the kind of thing you can give to a summer associate, and I ended up turning that into a note topic. If you've worked with professors, or if you've taken a class with a professor and you have the relationship with a professor where a professor might be willing to tell you, look, here are a couple things that I'm interested in that you might want to run down as potential topics, that's a great place to look for potential topics. But we'll talk a little bit later about how to work with professors during the course of a substantial writing project. Now, finally, and I want to put this last, one standby that people were often told to go to is U.S. Law Week, which is published by BNA or Matthew Bender or something, which has recent Court of Appeals cases, recent cert petitions to the Supreme Court, and would often be a place you could go to find circuit splits. I tend to encourage people not to write on circuit splits unless you're proof positive that you absolutely don't want to publish. If you think you may want to publish at some point, you don't want to write on a circuit split because the Supreme Court may very well take the case or another case involving the circuit split, resolve it before you can get the piece out, and then what do you do, right? You've wasted a lot of effort. One final piece before I pass the microphone on. Make sure you pick something that you actually have an interest in. I know that sounds really trivial. You may be desperate for an idea and something sounds just as good as the other, but this takes a lot of work. It can be incredibly enjoyable, but it can take a tremendous amount of work, and you're much more likely to get something meaningful out of the project. You're much more likely to finish it without tears and loss of skin if you actually have some sense of investment in the project.
Thank you, Troy. Before I start, if there's anybody that still wants a chair, we have a pile of them here. It looks like the jury. So actually, at the end of all this, we're just going to ask you to rule on whether we were any good or not. But I'm going to give you 1 second to bust across the room, and then I'm going to start. So this is it. It's like Frogger, if any of you remember Frogger. It's a video game. Do you remember video game? I'm sorry. Yeah, exactly. No, actually, there was ping pong tables. I'm actually going to disagree with a lot of what Troy just had to say.
Good. I like that. That's a note topic right there.
I want to start by explaining what I think it is that you're going to write, because I think it's important to get in your mind what it is that you're writing, because it's going to be different than what you've written in the past. So I often say that when you were in undergraduate school or high school, you wrote something that, for lack of a better word, because I can't think of what else to call it, was a book report. In the sense that somebody asked you to go learn a lot of stuff and assimilate and report back on that stuff. And that's a hard thing to do, and it's a hard thing to learn how to do, both the research part of it and the writing an assimilated version coherently. But that's not what you are going to do now. You are going to write something that has a thesis, that is an argument, that makes a claim. And that is an altogether different kind of thing to do. And if you're not making a claim, if when people ask, what are you writing about, you don't start by saying something like, I'm arguing, or the question I'm examining is whether, then you may be headed off on the wrong foot. And there's all kinds of different genres in which to do that. Hi, that's okay. I'm just going to let the... What is that?
There be electric shocks administered?
I don't know.
Some
I'm
point.
Wondering. I have the button that controls all of this.
Oh, okay.
Sorry.
So we'll deal. It's a small room. So the next thing I want to do is I want to just say some things about where to find topics. Before I do that, though, I actually do want to disagree with Troy pretty aggressively about the interest level point, about how much you have to love your topic. So I think we make a profound mistake. If I was in charge at the law school, which I was for a short period of time, at least in my own little domain, I would do the following thing. When you came to school for the beginning of your LLM year or your 2L year, there'd be a big fishbowl. And you'd walk in and you'd pluck a topic out of the fishbowl and you'd write that topic. And the reason that I would do that is not because it isn't better to write about something you love, but because it is hard to find topics. And it's harder to find topics. Could you sit back just a little bit? Are you just ready to go at me here? No. Because it is harder to find topics until you've written a student paper. Once you've done it, you kind of see what a topic looks like and feels like. And so what I would actually do, and I would urge all of the journals to do and all of the organizations, is I would ask their 3Ls to think up some topics and develop them and put them in a topic bank so that when people came, they would just write the topics that had already been developed. And I think the point of this exercise is largely methodological, to learn how to write this kind of thing. And once you get into it, almost any topic that's decent will turn out to be interesting once you start to learn about it. It's the starting to learn about it part that's important. Having said that, you know, where to look for topics. Well, this has gotten way easier than it used to be back when I was in law school when people wrote on stone tablets with chisels. For one reason, so the one place I've always sent people is to Law Week. And I think Law Week is a great place to look. And the reason I think Law Week is a great place to look is because Law Week is a list of court decisions, one after the other, after the other, after the other, by topic. And if courts are deciding cases about it, then there's very probably the germ of a topic there, something to write about. So I recommend that. Second, I actually think circuit splits are fine. And the reason I think they're fine is because the Supreme Court actually doesn't decide very many cases. In fact, it's a great job. They only seem to decide about 70 of them a year. And so the chance of those two falling together is slim. In addition, though, because I do think it's a serious risk, and Troy's right, you're sitting up again. I'm not done. Is because, you know, it's possible to revise that note about a circuit split in light of what the court ultimately does. But I actually think finding topics has gotten infinitely easier because of this thing called the internet. So there are blogs about just about everything having to do with law. There's Prof's Law blog, and there's Tax Prof's. Anything you could want to do, there's a blog. And on that blog is a lot of law professors who apparently have not very much anything else to do with their time, who are spouting off at the mouth about everything they can imagine. And in that spouting off, often there'll be lots of topics and ideas. And so I think doing this has gotten infinitely easier. If you just troll around for a while, you're going to find lots of ideas for topics. And the one other thing I want to mention topic-wise, and then I just want to say a couple things about writing, is that if there is an area that interests you, and remember, I'm the one that doesn't think that matters, but if there is an area that interests you, what you might not have learned in your prior legal research experience is that there are specialized reporters for virtually every single topic under the sun, or topic area under the sun, put out by people like BNA and Matthew Bender. And those reporters are full of reported decisions and topic areas and news about what's going on in the field. And again, if you just sit down and troll through there, you're going to find something to write about. The one other thing I'll disagree with Troy about, just to get this out of the way, is I actually think it's a rotten thing to walk into a professor's office and say, I have to write a paper, do you have any topic ideas? That's because there are a lot of you and not very many of us. We're ungunned, and we don't have that many topics at hand. I do think writing topics in seminars is a great idea. You're going to get lots of ideas from those. We've worked very, very hard to get people into seminars in their second year and in the LLM years. Let me just say a couple things about the writing, and I will stop. So one thing I want to explain is about the nature of the paper you're going to write. Because it is thesis-driven, there's an organization that is very common to student notes. And I'm going to spell it out and tell you what I think happens in each piece. First, there's an introduction. And I think the introduction contains a hook, something that makes it interesting or sexy to read the paper you're going to write. Second, a statement of your thesis, what you're going to claim. Third, a roadmap, the order in which you're going to argue it. And finally, possibly a bit of a lit review of what people have said beforehand. Part one then sets it up. It describes what the issues are that underlie the topic, what people have said, what the cases have held, what the policy problem is. Part two, then, is your analytics. It's the part where you actually go about and analyze the question that you've set up for yourself. Section one ends with the question set up. Section two then analyzes it. Section three concludes. As I often say, that's the least important part. For the purposes of what you're doing, the analytics are often most important. What's true about that is that every word you write is in service of that thesis. It's an arrow, start to finish. There shouldn't be anything extra. If you know something interesting, but it isn't in service of your thesis, it goes out, write something else. Every word's in service of the thesis. Last thing I want to say, topic sentences. So I think good legal writing moves through this thesis because each paragraph has a point. And each paragraph, which has at least three sentences, has a topic sentence which summarizes what the paragraph is about. And writers will tell you that topic sentences can go anywhere in the paragraph, the top, the bottom, the middle. In legal writing, they go in one place. Troy, do we agree on this?
Absolutely, Barry.
And that place is?
The first sentence.
Wrong. No, right. He's absolutely right. It's the first sentence. And in fact, when people watch me and say, gosh, you read a lot. How do you read all that? There's a secret. I only read the first sentence of every paragraph. So
Barry's absolutely right. When I worked for the co-chair of litigation at the firm I was at, and he said a really good brief should be one where the judge can read the first sentence of every paragraph in about, say, 10 minutes and get the point and be persuaded. That's a really good brief.
I have something right. Okay, I'm done. Kathleen.
Okay. Is this thing on? Oh, it is. Okay. So I'm going to avoid getting involved in the how to pick your topic and move on to a second topic, which is now you have a topic and you're sitting in front of your blank computer screen. How do you actually write this thing? Right? Now, you've all written papers before, and they may have been of a slightly different variety, so I'm not going to give you the, you know, how to write a paper from scratch. You all know some of that. What I want to talk about is how to write a paper as a lawyer, and I think this is going to bring in some of the themes that we've already been talking about here. So I want to give you kind of an image and a different way of thinking about writing the paper. So I don't want you to think of writing the paper as a course assignment or a graduation assignment. I want you to think of it as a litigation. You are going to trial. You would not start preparing for trial a week before the trial. You would never do that. You might cram for an exam, although I would not recommend it a week before the exam, but you would prepare for a trial well in advance. You need to do the same with the paper. The paper is, we talk about writing, so much of writing a paper has nothing to do with writing. It's very little of it is done in front of your keyboard. You need to read a lot. Think of this as going out. If you were going to trial, your paper due date is your trial date. You would read every decision that had any bearing on the case that you're trying. You would try to find anything that gave you a sense of what could help you to win, right? So you want to do that for your paper as well. You want to go out and you want to research everything. This ties into the lit review. And this would also go into a brief, if you were writing a brief. Same idea. You would also, if you were going to trial, you would want to review every piece of evidence. You would want to interview every witness. You would have to make those appointments ahead of time. You couldn't do that a week before the trial. That pursuit of the evidence, those interviews, are going to change the arguments you're going to make. So you need to be doing all of this well in advance. That's another section of the paper that's going to give you all your kind of background on what other people have said. And you want to make sure that you have that all kind of tightly put together. None of that involves writing. Remember, you're not sitting in front of your computer screen yet. You want to be doing all of these things ahead. Then, if you were going to trial, you would probably spend some time thinking very hard about the arguments you're going to make. And you would not just sit there and think about them by yourself. You'd probably bounce them off other people. You wouldn't want the judge or the jury to be hearing your arguments and be the first one hearing them and be able to knock them down, right? So you want to, if you're in a class with other people talking about the same issues, if you have a professor or advisor that's interested in the same issues, maybe go and talk about some of the arguments you're going to make in advance. People in big trials will go and they'll get test juries. You want to do some equivalent of that. You don't want to be sitting in a room, all of your arguments being formed just within those four walls. So this is an interactive process. And the beauty of this, which you don't get when you're a lawyer and you're going to trial, is that, you know, if you're writing this for a course and there's a professor, if you come to some roadblock, you can actually go and potentially talk to your professor and an advisor. You can't go and talk to the judge before the trial and say, hey, what do you think of this argument? But if you plan ahead, you can do that in this case. So you really want to use that to your advantage. And then, let's see, what else have I got here? The other things that are going to be important, and also thinking about this almost like a trial or a brief, is your opening and your closing statements. As Professor Friedman has already mentioned, you really want to start out with a hook. You don't want to go in and just start blabbing about what other people have said about your topic. You want to tell the judge or the jury why they were going to come down on your side of the case. So you want to have that hook. You want to tell right up front what your point is going to be, how you're going to get there. We've all seen all of these legal thrillers where somebody starts their opening argument and they tell you, in this case, I'm going to show you why the defendant, whatever, you know, did this, didn't do this. You wanna do the same thing for this paper. You wanna lay it all out. So if you're thinking about the paper as something that you're writing, you know, just to put ideas on paper, you really wanna think of it more as an argument that you're making. And this is gonna really, I mean, it makes sense. You're all in law school. You're trying to get the skills that you're gonna use in the legal world. Use this paper as an exercise for that real world exercise. Do I still have some time?
We have another couple minutes.
Okay, so let me go back a step to something mundane. I'm a big fan of outlines, right? So you want to use your outline not so much to kind of lay out exactly what you're going to do, but just to keep organized. Like I said, there are a lot of moving pieces here. You're not just sitting in front of a page. You're researching. You're developing arguments. You want to keep all of that kind of focused so that when you sit down, you kind of have a roadmap for what you're going to do. I find this is a little bit strange, but I find that I have a hard time starting to write a section that isn't the opening statement. But of course, you kind of logically want to leave that for the end because that's when you actually know what you're trying to say. You know, if you need to write something just to get something on the page, go ahead and write an incoherent opening statement. But know that you're going to go back to it. And really start out with your lit review, your ideas about what other people have written, get that stuff out on the page, and give yourself a lot of time. So if you take this advice and kind of schedule this like a trial, you're gonna start your research of the lit review 2 weeks in advance, you're gonna have 2 weeks to do argument preparation and so forth, add some weeks in there. If you can write out kind of, or do your reading on all of the precedential literature and start thinking about what you wanna say, and then set it aside for a little bit of time. And let that time be a chance for it to kind of marinate in your skull. I find that, and I'm sure that you've all had this experience in other aspects of life, sometimes when you're not thinking about some problem that's been kind of in the back of your mind, it comes to you. You want to build that in. If you start trying to write a project of this kind a week in advance, you're not going to have enough time for all of those ideas that some part of your brain is marinating on to really come up and jump out with a new insight. So add in some time into your schedule when you start planning this out to let those kind of moments, those aha moments, happen.
I'm a little stuck on the marinated brain, but Erin.
So I'm going to talk about two things as the person who most recently went through this process. One is working with your mentor, which I'm going to talk about second, or advisor, and finding that mentor or advisor. The first thing I'm going to talk about, though, is mistakes I made. And I was going to come up with a really clever PowerPoint that had, like, topics that seemed funny and witty. And then I kept thinking about the mistakes I made, and the mistakes I made were all about me not knowing myself as a writer. And the truth is, me as a presenter is not so into the PowerPoint, and I ditched that idea. Every mistake I made was about getting advice from other people. We're all giving you advice, and not filtering that advice through what I knew about myself and how I worked and what made things interesting to me. So I can tell you stories about what didn't work for me and why, but I think it's really important that you guys do know yourself as writers. And for me, writing this paper was actually pretty scary. Some of you have just graduated. Some of you have been journalists and been writing under your own name for a long time. I've been out of school for 4 years and hadn't written anything under my own name for a very long time. That was a thesis, and that terrified me. Did I still know how to do it? Why was it taking me so much longer? In college, I pounded out 20-page papers in an evening, like, and this is gonna take me 6 months to write 10,000 words, really? But it's a different project, and I'm a different person. And I think it's actually probably better than a lot of stuff I put together the night before in college. I hope. So things that I did, because I didn't know what I was doing. One of my professors gave me excellent advice about how to structure my day and how to make sure I was making progress on my writing. And he told me, you know, what a great thing to do, some really good advice, is set aside some time each day to write. And I, being a diligent advisor, like dutifully put in my Google Calendar an hour every day block where I was supposed to write. And lo and behold, every time it came to that hour, there was something more pressing that meant that that hour never happened and that writing never happened, and I was pretty far behind in the imaginary schedule that I should have put together for myself. Had I thought about it, had I talked to some other people who have some insight into how I work, it would have made a lot more sense for me to block out a couple of weekends, to realize that for me, like, I can't write in an hour. It takes me 2 hours to even get through all the Slate articles that I need to read before I feel comfortable writing. And to acknowledge that as part of my writing process and not to beat myself up about the fact that, you know, writing is hard and the time that you're putting into this project includes that break time of reading Slate, even in a firm you can't bill for it. Unlike Kathleen, I would actually say start writing earlier, because I spent a lot of time reading everything under the sun, and I had a lot of trouble. I actually knew this going in, and that was why I was supposed to start writing early, and lo and behold, I didn't know myself. Figuring out what was relevant and what was not relevant, and I think that's actually a really hard thing to know when you're starting to do legal research. A lot more things seem relevant than turn out to be when you write your paper. So having starting writing before you're reading everything in the sun, I think, can help focus, but again, it's about you and knowing where you feel comfortable doing. The third major mistake I think I made was, as Professor Friedman said, not understanding what the note is. And the note is not a thesis. It is not a doctoral thesis. It's actually not even an undergraduate thesis. You've had 1 year of a law school education. You've been exposed to lots of different doctrine, and you're supposed to like master something very, very narrow, and that involves getting some background information. And it's all new. And the idea that you're gonna become an expert in the year that you're writing this paper, after a year of overview, is maybe some of you can do it and some of you have advanced degrees and are already ready to be experts, but I was not. And the idea of being an expert totally scared me, and it made it very hard for me to write. And you don't need to be an expert to write a 60-page paper on a topic. And for me, that was like a process of learning and was a big mistake that I think I made. So those are my mistakes. I'm sure you will make yours, tell other people, but I think the most important thing is filter all the advice you get through what you know about yourself as a writer and as a thinker. Working with advisors. I agree that I wrote my paper in a seminar. It was a wonderful, wonderful experience, and I'm thrilled that I did it. It gave me structure. It gave me deadlines that I had to meet, and that was fabulous. Not all of you are going to have topics that are going to fit neatly in seminars. Talk to your friends who are 2Ls and 3Ls. Talk to the mentors that were assigned to you. Find out, you know, who people have enjoyed working with and why, because students have opinions about that. Again, filter all of that information through the lens of you are a different person than the person giving you advice, and you might think differently about the relationship. But ask what it was like to work. Ask what kind of feedback you got. But also ask that person about their work habits. Because they could say, I got no feedback from someone, and the reason they didn't get any feedback is because they didn't do good things to let their advisor give you feedback. And I think there are two good things that you can do to get the best possible feedback. One, let whoever you're writing your paper with know ahead of time what your personal deadlines are in conjunction with the class deadlines. And so I'm going to get you a rough draft by the end of spring break. I'm going to get you a rough draft by the middle of November. Then, actually, does that work for your schedule? Will you be able to give me feedback if that's true? If it doesn't work, make sure you're on their schedule. Then meet that deadline. The other way to get really good feedback is to present things in writing. And this was actually a mistake I made. I went to my advisor numerous times, and he was very, very kind to me with these sort of rambling questions as I was thinking through. And he did help me think through, but that was never as helpful as the times when I actually came to him with a written product and asked for feedback about where I should go and what the problems with my argument were. The final thing I will say about working with an advisor is the negative feedback I got was the best possible feedback I got. And the aggressively negative feedback I occasionally got was even better. Every time I came to my advisor, he made me state my thesis in a sentence. I think I can now state my thesis in a sentence. And that's a very good thing for the point of writing an argument. The final thing I'll say, and this will be, I think, unusual as a student at the law school, there is a lot of ability to get extensions on these kinds of projects. In fact, I think that we can now get a work in progress on our transcript instead of an incomplete for a substantial writing, which makes it look even better to get an extension. The best thing my advisor did, well, of the many good things my advisor did for me, when I asked for an extension, he actually told me no. He told me to finish the project. And to the extent that you can, within a semester or within a year, actually finish this, your lives will be so much better. Because believe me, you do not want to be working this over the summer. And now, professors can feel free to disagree with me.
No, I think we agree with everything you said. I agree with almost everything Erin said.
Same here.
We're going to move to questions. I do want to underscore one thing Erin said, because I think it's a composite of wonderful advice. And actually, I'm going to connect it to something Kathleen said. So I'm hearing this a lot in the world and around the law school. And it's really, really good advice. And it matters more, particularly in a market that's a tough market, which is, it's extraordinary how many people say they're going to do something and then don't deliver when they say they're going to deliver. And I'm actually advising somebody who's going on in the teaching market. And I said quite bluntly the other day, I'm here for you as busy as I am, but you pick the day that you're going to get me something in writing, and it arrives on that day, because I'm going to arrange my schedule to be there for you on that basis. And so that is a very good life lesson, and I think it's very important. And combined with that, these papers take time to write. I actually think they take longer than 6 months to write. And I spent a lot of this summer watching folks I was supposed to write clerkship letters for not have their student writing done. And it annoys me, because I'm there ready to spend a lot of time writing letters, and it's their job to get the note done. Don't procrastinate. Whatever your individual writing style is, dig in now, dig in as soon as you can, and do it so that it's done at the end of the school year. Having now been the hard ass on the panel, we're going to go to questions. So,
but of course, you're less likely to procrastinate if you have an initial interest in the topic.
I've never seen any data on that. So this is the question time. We're going to do the same thing we usually do, but I'm told the mics aren't working. So instead, the people that usually would carry the mics are simply going to lift you up and put you on the table when you ask your question. Now, would you ask it as loudly as you could? Whichever one of us grabs it to answer it is going to repeat the question briefly for the recording. I will remind you, as I forgot to do last week, but should have, we webcast this, and so if you don't want to be on the web, don't ask a question. That said, questions, comments, thoughts, disagreement with Professor McKenzie, any and all of the above is more than welcome. Yes.
Okay, so I have a question.
Stand up, tell us who you are. Not on the table.
So part of this might come from the fact that I...
Who are you? What year are you? I'm going to answer that because it's a technical, rule-oriented question. The question is, rather than writing in a seminar or in a directed research, what about writing through an organization So there are actually rules and things that bear upon this, plus one of my mantras. One of my mantras is don't write without credit. If you're writing, get credit for it. You have a substantial writing obligation or a thesis obligation, depending upon whether you're a JD or an LLM or whatnot. But don't do it in a format in which you can't get credit for it. And we have done a tremendous amount of work institutionally to move away from the directed research model where you had to chase faculty members down in the hall and nab them and tackle them and get them to be your advisor, to creating many more seminars and preferencing in the two L's and LLMs and people who are doing their substantial writing. That's the right place to do it. And the problem with doing it through an organization in general is because the organization can't officially sign off on your substantial writing requirement. Having said that, Professor McKenzie gave you a good example of where a topic came from an employment, and it would not be uncommon for you to be writing with guidance from somebody outside. But again, remember, this is a thesis, and these are questions that need to be answered that have an argument to them, and so you have to make sure that where you're getting that source is the best source. We're packed in like sardines, so I'm going to just pause for a minute if folks really want to leave, but then I'm going to ask you to bear with us for the next half hour just because it's tough to follow the questions. So I'm actually going to do the unusual and give us 2 minutes to escape. This is when all the good stuff is about to happen, though. We're going to hand out topics. Great. Is there another question?
Share your deepest thoughts with us. Well, just as a show of hands, how many of you have sort of a tentative topic that you think you're probably going to write on? And how many of you got that tentative topic from class? And how many of you got it? Well, how many of you got it from class? From somewhere else?
Question was about interacting with professors and going to them and kind of interacting. I think a lot depends on the professor, of course, but I want to echo something that was said earlier about working with professors. You're going to get a better response if you already have your question sort of worked out in writing, so that the person that you're going in, and I think all of you can imagine being in the recipient's shoes, right? So somebody comes in and says, I'm working on this topic, don't really know what my thesis is yet, I've read some stuff, and I have these questions. You know, so it's all kind of very vague. It's hard to give really good feedback. So it's not that they're being difficult or harried, but it's actually hard to distill it. So if you can distill it as far as you can without their help, you know, for them and say, here's where the problem really is. I've read these three things and they seem to contradict in these two ways and I can't really understand how, you know, piece A fits with piece B, and I was hoping that maybe you could help me work that out. That's a concrete question that the professor can help you answer, potentially. Or at least, you know, might be willing to send you off to some sources that might help you answer that question. You're going to get a much more helpful reaction if you've distilled it as far down as possible. But if you're sort of in the part of your researching before you start to really, you know, get it down to paper where you don't really have it worked out to where you can articulate it, then that probably means it's not yet time to go see the professor. You want to really have an articulate question before you go, or you're going to be kind of wasting your time probably because the professor's not going to be able to give you much back, and you might be wasting the professor's time and they might be a little bit less likely to want to meet with you later when you actually have an articulate question. So really try to get it what boiled down to as specific a question as you can before you go in so that you can imagine an answer You know, you want to be able to imagine, what could I come out of this meeting with that I didn't go in with, and how am I likely to get that? So give the person that you're talking to, whether it's a professor or a colleague or whoever it is, as much of an advantage in helping you as possible.
I just want to say I agree with everything Kathleen said, and I actually didn't agree with Barry on one point, which he thought we had disagreed on. This just shows you the indeterminacy of communication among humans. But when I said a place to get a topic might be a professor, I sort of prefaced that with, you know, if you have a relationship, let's say you're working as an RA for a professor, and you've been working on a project or something, you say, you know, I'm really interested in this project, and I know you're writing on it, but, you know, it seems like there might be a little piece that I could write on as well. That's sort of what I meant. But I think Kathleen's absolutely right. You get much more out of talking to a professor if you've done some spade work first, if you've actually kind of dug in. Now, there are two things you can get from the professor. The professor could tell you, that's an obvious question. It's not something that you want to spend time on. Or the professor could tell you, I know that's a really great question, it sounds very interesting, but it turns out Jones has an article that's coming out on that. I just saw him present it, you know, 6 months ago. Professors will generally have a much better sense of the literature and pieces of the literature that you might not look at in the first or even second instance.
Other questions? The woman in the back and then the gentleman in front of her. Yep, that's you. Who are you and what year?
My name is Tia. I'm a 1L.
Getting started early.
I was thinking about Erin's expert expectation idea and just wondering who the audience is for these papers. I mean, when you're writing it, are you thinking about the professor who's going to read it or the sort of community at large or someone else?
This is a very good question. When I was, again, this is all advice is self-replication, as Erin said. When I was writing, I was thinking about potential clerkship. That was one audience. Obviously, I was thinking about the advisor who was going to be giving me a grade. I did my paper as substantial writing. And I thought, if at some point down the road I want to enter academia, I want this to be something that can show some start of a later career, some ability to write creatively and interestingly. Now, I think Barry may disagree a little bit with me on this, because if the idea is to do the project and to understand and perform the method, then you don't have to care as much about showing your audience that you've picked a topic that's incredibly creative and that shows the start of a long research agenda. But you might have multiple audiences. I mean, if you just want to get credit, that's one thing. But you might want to get a clerkship, or you might want to later go into academia, or you might want to influence policy. It really depends on you and what you're trying to get out of the project.
For me, when it comes to audience, it's always my mother. Erin, do you want to say anything?
The one thing I didn't say is another potential audience that you may be writing for if you're on a journal or hope to be published is the note pool audience, which can be, unfortunately, dramatically different from your advisor. And the more you can integrate if you hope to publish, what your journal's expectations are into your writing while you're integrating your advisor's recommendations into your writing, the less likely it is that you'll have to rewrite your paper when you want to publish it, which does occasionally happen.
The one thing I will say about audience is when courts and practitioners cite scholarship, they cite much more student scholarship than you might think, and much less academic scholarship. And there's a reason for that, which is that the student authors tend to write about more tangible things that have an effect in the world. So it's actually a neat thing when you write that there's this chance that you're going to get cited by people in their briefs or get cited in court opinions. Who are you and what year are you?
My name's Sean, with 2L, I guess. Much like a lot of my classmates, I'm feeling like I'm being pulled this semester in 12 different directions, more so than last year, surprisingly, and also differently, none of which happened to be academic. A lot of extracurricular stuff, stuff outside of school, and I wonder if I add a paper on top of this, you know, what effect that's going to have on everything else. And at least the way my schedule panned out, it looks as if next semester would make more sense, but the feeling I've been getting from you guys is don't wait, get it done. Is there any good reason to wait?
So the question is about schedule. You're 2L. Instead of being told where to go every day, you now have your own schedule. You have lots of outside activities, extracurriculars, job search, all that other stuff. Is it okay to wait? The other panelists may disagree. I'm going to tell you no, right? I think the time to dig in is as early as possible, unless you're so certain that, say, this semester is just impossible for you and you have a free space next semester that you can really kind of dig in and do a lot of work. And the reason is you don't want to be in the position where, I won't do it this semester, and then, of course, next semester rolls around, and, well, gosh, I have lots of stuff I want to do then, too. And next thing you know, it's the second semester of your 3L year, and you're scrambling for something so that you can graduate. I just think you're much better off, especially if you want to try to get this published and you're on a journal, you're much better off starting and doing, you know, the real heavy digging in the first semester of your second year, if at all possible. Because, as Erin said, the note pool process, different journals obviously have different ways of processing notes, but that process can be quite lengthy and can require you to do a substantial amount of revising.
I just wanted to add on just a tiny bit to that. I would also say, you know, get started now, but if you can't, you know, for some reason, you know, there's something on your schedule this fall that's really large and you know it's going away in the spring, even if that's the case, find your topic this semester. Do the research on some of the literature review this semester. Maybe you do most of the writing and the argumentation and so forth next semester, but don't say, well, I can't finish it this semester, so I'm not going to start it until next semester. Get that topic as early as possible, because as we've talked about, just finding a topic can be so much work. So if you at least end the semester with the topic and maybe a little bit of the reading done to kind of get the background on the research, then you'll at least put yourself in a good position at the beginning of the next semester.
We have done so much work institutionally to make it possible for you to be in seminars in the fall semester. And we did it because we believe that that's the time to start writing. Now, often the seminar that interests you wasn't in the fall. You might be in a seminar in the spring. Here's a tactic. It doesn't keep you from starting to think about your topic now and finding a topic. And I don't want to speak for all of my colleagues, but many of my colleagues I know are more than open to having you send them an email and say, I'm signed up for your seminar, and I'm going to do my substantial writing paper, and I actually think I have a topic. Can I run it by you? Now, I cannot sign on strongly enough to what everybody said here about approaching people with something written that you've thought out. But from my perspective, if I'm doing a seminar in the spring, I'm delighted to have students who have their topics in the fall because they can dig in writing. It's also true, as busy as you are, and that's how the second year is, it's as busy as can be. You know, there are lots of times to work on your writing. You know, I get the point about the one-hour blocks, that I actually think you need lots of time to settle into your writing. I certainly do. But you could take steps toward it in lots of small spaces. You can do some research in little bites. If you're on an airplane, it's a great time to read some stuff while you're paying attention to that delicious turkey sandwich that you bought for $4.95. And so, you know, if you're always moving in the direction, if you're making yourself keep moving, then at least you can get to a certain point when you have the bigger blocks of time. Other questions?
Brett and Tuol, I kind of wanted to push back maybe on the clerkship thing. I've heard that actually you can use work product from your Tuol summer and maybe turn that easier because it's shorter and sort of fits 12 pages as opposed to compressing out 60 pages. And then the second issue is sort of in law school, especially as Tuol's competing in sort of, you have to be strategic about time. And so it's easy to know that, say, you have the statute, the state agency you want to go after, but at the end of the day, the advice to us is always be very specific in your note topic. And to be very specific, you really have to know what it's going to turn on, and sort of how you strike that balance of actually digging. But digging correctly, so you're not just digging down maybe rabbit holes.
So Troy's chomping at the bit to answer this first question. So
I'm going to ask him to do that, and then I thought maybe one of you could answer the second.
So the question was two parts. The first one was a pushback on one potential audience, which is judges hiring clerks. And the suggestion was that many judges really are fine with your sending in as a writing sample something you've worked on as a 2L, working at a firm or in a public interest organization, you know, a practice memo. And then there was a second part of the question about sort of how to balance getting something specific enough and also digging so that you don't kind of run yourself ragged. So it's certainly true that there are many judges who are perfectly fine, even prefer a 10-page memo that's a very clear sort of doctrinal memo that you would give to a senior partner if you work at a firm for a summer or something along those lines. Here's the hook, though, or here's the hitch. There are many judges, particularly appellate court judges, but not exclusively, who prefer to see something a little bit more academic, a little bit lengthier. And secondly, remember that when you're looking for professors to write letters of recommendation for you, a professor who is working with you on your substantial writing is going to make a much better recommender than random partner who supervised your 10-page practice memo when you were at a firm for the summer. When I write a letter for somebody who I supervised in a seminar or in directed research, I can say lots of great things about how this person writes, the creativity of the person, how much work it took, you know, how the person was a self-starter. I mean, all of the things that judges like to hear. And so it's not necessarily that the end product itself is what judges are looking for, but that end product is always going to be twinned with somebody who's supervising and working with you who can serve as a very, very, very influential recommender during the courtship process.
That all seems right. Now, the second part of the question, which I took to be the, I'm interested in some broad things, but I get the instruction to write more narrowly, but, you know, how much drilling down do you do and what's the right level of generality? Either of you want to speak to that?
I wanted to speak to that a little bit. I think the idea that you're going to come up with a topic and that all the research that you're going to do to get that topic whittled down is going to be productive is just wrong. You're going to waste a lot of time, a lot of time. You're going to go in all sorts of dead ends. If, you know, some of you might be lucky, maybe this won't happen to you, but the average writing exercise is a very inefficient process. You will probably spend a lot of time researching topics that don't pan out. You'll take a topic that looks promising and find some research that makes it not work. So there is going to be probably a lot of drilling down. And then, and that's just on the kind of finding the topic. There's also, I think the writing process itself requires a whole lot of extra time that's not very productive. So Erin was talking about the hours of web surfing or slate reading that needed to happen before any productive writing happened. Don't beat yourself up too much over that, because it's sort of necessary. If that's part of what gets you to write, then, you know, you need to just accept that and go with it. That's not totally wasted time if it's what finally gets you to put words down on the page. So don't worry so much about that. I like to think of that as that time where the ideas are just sort of, you know, in my subconscious, getting kind of sort of sorted out without my active thinking. So I think it's actually fairly productive, but it doesn't always feel productive. So I guess, you know, being kind of forced or wanting to write a paper is going to require a lot of wasted time for one reason or another.
Other questions? Yeah, all the way back.
I'm working on it too. I appreciate Erin saying that you don't have to be an expert to write a substantial writing book, but I don't feel like I know anything after 1 year. So I guess
what's your seminar about?
Morgan knows a lot, actually. Morgan was a former student of mine. You know plenty.
Because you're such an excellent professor.
That's right. That's right. So the question is...
my students have a little bit of a disadvantage in this.
The question is, what do you do when you don't feel you have any expertise, that you feel that you might know a little bit about a lot of things, but you don't really have a grasp of one area that you think makes you confident enough to go forward? I wouldn't really worry about that. Part of writing is learning, as Kathleen was pointing out. In the process of learning, you will make yourself into an expert on whatever narrow area you're writing about. Now, you're not going to know as much as somebody who has been teaching and writing in the area for 40 years, but you're going to know a lot about an area. It's one of the reasons why it helps to keep your topic, to keep narrowing and refining your topic as much as possible to an actual claim that doesn't cover the entire territory, because you want to be able at the end of the process to say, look, I have marshaled all of these authorities in favor of my argument. I know what I'm talking about. So this is not something where you need to have some prior expertise. The process will sort of turn you into somebody who has developed a level of expertise.
Oh, can I just weigh in here? Because I think this is also sometimes a problem, not universally, but particular to women who are sometimes find it harder to, at least I do, find it harder to speak before I feel like I know everything about anything, and how can I make a claim about something?
Whereas men being just the opposite will often...
I'm not saying, but I do think, it has been my personal experience that this is sometimes true. The blogosphere bears this out quite strongly, actually. And so I think there's the narrowing down the topic and feeling confident in yourself, and for me it's also a process of thinking back, like sort of also self-reflection. Look, I have done a tremendous amount of research. At some point, you're gonna have to be able to say that, and you have to trust that what you did is worthwhile and you learned something in it, and you weren't just going down a rabbit hole, and that's, I think, sometimes just a leap of faith that you have, it was a leap of faith I had to make to start putting paper to pen.
Also, professors can play a role in sort of telling you, you're on the right track. Or pushing back and saying, no, 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 you're getting off the track. But that can be helpful as well. So the feedback you can get, again, if you've started digging in and you've done your homework, is a way of reassuring yourself that you're not just kind of lost.
This is apropos of maybe nothing, or at least several of the things that have been said, but I realize I really want to say it. So it falls in that space about settling down to write and what writing's about. I have a hard job. Because what I have to do is I have to go into my office and close the door and stare at a blank computer screen and look deep in my soul and say something. And it would be really great, actually, if my phone would just ring or I would get an email or there was something I needed to do, because then I would just do it and check it off my list. And I think that's true about writing, and you all have written enough to know that, which is that, you know, writing is a very difficult thing to do because it makes you decide to move all of the clutter out of your way and sit in front of that empty screen and figure out whether you have something to say and say it. But the other thing I so very much want to say, this is why I popped up to say this, is writing is and should be a labor of absolute love. And even if you don't think that you love it right now, it should become something you love. It's your chance to read about something and learn about something and reflect about something and tell the world about that thing that you've thought about. And it's very, very difficult in our incredibly overly electronic, busy days to appreciate the beauty in that. But after having taught for, you know, as long as at twice what some of you are alive, I have come to realize that there's this incredible joy that comes out of it. And it's hard to do. It's harder and harder in my life to sort of shut the door and find the time to stare terrified at that computer screen and think, am I going to say something that anybody could conceivably want to hear? But you've got to give yourself the chance to do that, including all the rustling around and getting settled and being afraid and not being confident, because when you finally put words to paper and it turns into something, I think that it's just incredibly satisfying in a way that many other things that you'll do in this life will not be.
One additional thought on that. There's a quote by Justice Scalia that I absolutely love. He says, I don't necessarily enjoy every moment of writing, but I enjoy having written. Right, and that's true. There is a tremendous sense of accomplishment that you get when you put the conclusion and the final period, and it goes out. I mean, you really do feel that you've brought something into the world. It's a wonderful feeling, even if every step along the way can be not so wonderful and terrifying.
My name is Michael. I'm at 2L. So a lot has obviously come from different disciplines besides the law before coming here. And I think we all can understand, you know, what paper that's about the law or is a legal paper. But I'm curious, you know, where is the line drawn between what's a legal paper and what's a paper that's an X other discipline paper about the law? Like, where do you find, like, I know, like, you know, like, I'm a history major, and, like, I know what a history paper looks like, but I don't want to write a history paper. But, I, you know what I mean? So I'm just kind of seeing, like, where's the line between the two?
That's a really good question, and one of the things that I think is great about the law is that it's very large and encompassing. So there's a lot of room for a lot of different types of paper in terms of topics. I think what makes these papers that we're talking about here similar is less about what the topics have in common with each other, because people will write some, and if we took the most diverse topics in this room, whatever they are, you would wonder how they're still in the same discipline. What makes the papers similar and makes them a good legal exercise is more the structure and the method of the paper. It's about the fact that you're making an argument, the fact that you're supporting it in a certain way, the fact that you're presenting it in a certain way. That's what kind of underpins a lot of these things. If you're making an argument that has a strong historical basis, there's nothing that makes that less legal for having a historical component. But it has to have some kind of argument about maybe how history affects some legal thing that's happening, you know, today or maybe historically. But there has to be an argument, and it needs to be kind of supported in a certain type of way. So I would say it's less about really the facts and the topic itself than it is about the method.
Just to follow up on that, very often people who come from other disciplines, if they start writing, they tend to maybe try to write in the former discipline. One thing that which is fine, but one thing that distinguishes, I think, legal writing from other kinds of writing is that legal writing tends to be writing to a problem, right? The argument often comes out of a particular problem or conundrum, and that's one thing that often sets off legal writing. The method is one that isn't itself in love with methodology. It is one that is writing to a problem. I have found a problem, and I'm going to talk about the problem. I might draw on historical sources or economic sources or sociological sources, but I'm going to write to the problem. That's one thing that I think distinguishes legal writing from other kinds of writing in other disciplines.
Gentleman in the purple.
I'm Kevin, I'm a 1L. Maybe related question, you gave us some good places to look for ideas for topics. But I was curious, especially since you said that the criteria for publication can be different from the criteria of what makes a good substantial writing topic, where you would direct us for some reading to give us a sense of, to look at good examples of what would be a substantial writing paper.
So that's a good question. I'm going to preface it by saying that if you're a 1L, you shouldn't be worrying about this at all. I mean, it's fine to be here and listen, but you're just way ahead of the game if you're being concerned about it. Not that I ever think reading is a bad thing to do. You know, one thing I always tell people, I'm sorry, the question is where might we start reading to think about things that would be good to write about or to see what the genre itself looks like. So I have a mantra, which is you need to read to write, and I believe that. When people can't find topics, I always say, you know, I always ask the same question, what are you reading? Because if you're reading and you're bright, you're going to read enough stuff, and eventually you're just going to start to disagree with it. You're going to have a topic. And I tell people just to go out and read. You know, it's a student note, that's what most of what you're going to write. So go to some journals here. We have lots of journals at this one school, and they have very different genres to them. Check out some journals at some other schools. Just read some student notes. And I think, you know, after you've read about five of them, you'll have the idea perfectly well.
My name is Guillermo. I'm an LLM student. I don't know if you have some extra advice for people who are foreign, and we don't have English as a first language. Also, we have an LLM degree and a law degree, first law degree, and we have made substantial topics, thesis. It's different when we don't have the common law background. So even though if I focus my topic on international issues, I will still have the main difference about having a background in case law, common law, and the English.
I would have thought I thought Kathleen might have been apt, since she has written some comparative work. So I find with LLM students that you actually start with a huge comparative advantage. First, you may have a law degree, and second, you know something about something that a lot of us don't know about, and so that's always interesting. And so you're undoubtedly going to notice things about this other system that are of interest. Now, you can write about questions that were apt from home. Nothing rules that out of bounds. You can write about things that are different between home and here or somewhere else, civilian and common law systems. My advice is very much the same, with all due deference to the
The question, by the way, the question is, how do LLM start writing? You know, I understand that doing English as a second language is a difficult or third or fourth thing to do, and it can be a struggle. But my advice is kind of the same, which is you have to read to write. So start reading, and start reading in your native tongue, the legal literature, and start reading in English, and see what the literature looks like. And at some level, I think you're going to find it easier to find things to write about. Good. The question, which I'm going to turn over to, I think, Erin, is, so you've got a topic, you start researching, and instantly you're overwhelmed. There's all kinds of stuff, and you're reading, but how do you keep track? Is there some systemic way to go about this?
This is more what I plan to do next time, more than what I did. But I think, again, you have to know yourself. Like, if you are the organized person that wants to use, like, make a list of everything you've read, and sort of catalog its thesis, I'm sure that that would be really wonderful and like probably incredibly useful once you started writing. I'm never, ever gonna do that. And I just know that. So my plan going forward is to actually start putting pen to paper earlier when I have a topic, start writing what I think my argument is, and then seeing if I can find facts to back it up. And if I can't find facts to back it up, I'm gonna have to be very willing to change what my argument is, if I'm gonna go through this approach. But I think it means sort of fleshing out the argument as you're writing.
So facts first or thesis first? Usually it's when you read about facts and then
I think it's about making it, making it a much more reciprocal process. Like I had this idea that I was gonna maintain a completely open mind. Professor Friedman was actually at a session where I was like, well, I just don't know the answer yet. I have the question, but I don't know the answer. I haven't read enough. And I think it would have been I would have been much more focused had I had a tentative answer and then sought to prove that true and been willing to say no, it's false. And then also breaking those questions down into individual research projects, right? So in order to answer this question, I need to know X, Y, and Z, and asking each individual question as a question that you're writing as you're researching an answer.
You know, I writing is painful for me, and I'm very slow. And what I do is I take a lot of notes, because I don't remember anything. And so I write notes as I write. I'm trying actually to get better at just reading for a while before I feel like I need to write notes, and then I have to go back and read everything else because, as I said, I don't remember anything. But what I do is I just number them. I just take notes in numbered order. Until the structure of the piece emerges. And then as soon as it emerges, I create categories. And then I try to shuffle my notes into the categories. And from then on, I just write my notes into those categories. And then I'll do that more fine-grained. So I think that the earlier you can see the structure of what you're writing and create some sort of headings for yourself, it gives you folders in which to put the things that you're encountering that you need. Yes? Right in the blue, the woman in blue? So I have a comment about this. I was tempted to ask who's teaching the seminar. I am going to ask who's teaching the seminar. Who's teaching the seminar? Here's the deal. The question is, how do we write this thing in 6 months? And the answer is, you're not going to. And you can tell Ann Milgram I said so. Though I still don't think that she's done a bad thing. In fact, she's probably done a terrific thing. So we actually changed the rule for transcripts here because everybody gets an incomplete, and then employers want to know why you've got an incomplete, so we gave it a different name. It's called, like, not an incomplete or in progress or something. I tell everybody this. I tell this most often to people that want to become academics, and they're out in practice, and they're going to write their paper, and they're going to get their job talk ready. And, you know, they turn out 50-page briefs or position papers at a drop of the hat. And I say, yeah, I did that too, but it's going to take you a year to write a paper. And they don't believe me, but you know what? That's how long it takes to write a paper, a year. Now, having said that, I urge everybody to have a draft by the end of the semester or early the next semester. And I actually think that's maybe the most useful thing to say to anyone who's imposed that hard a deadline, which is what winter break is for is writing the draft of your paper. But you do want to get a draft out somehow, miraculously, by January-ish, because that's just a beginning point where you're going to get feedback and you're going to want to rewrite it. And so I think that's the right drill. I'd be glad to speak to Ann Milgram about this, but that's my sense of the best way to go about it. We are almost out of time, so I want to make a couple of announcements and thank you all and thank the panelists. First, next week, important point, tell everyone you know, fantastic forum, not on Wednesday at lunchtime. It's on Thursday in the evening. The title is The Gender of Atrocity, Accountability versus Peace in Sudan and Beyond. It's going to be in Greenberg from 6 to 8. We've got Catherine McKinnon and the prosecutor for the International Criminal Court, and it's going to be a very, very, very good two-hour program. The week after that, we will be back in the usual time slot talking about U.S. versus Arizona and immigration reform, and then the week after that, we will do a Supreme Court preview. We've got terrific speakers for all of these. I want to thank all of these folks, and thank you for coming.